adapted for radio by Toby Haydock.
Just take it as far as that thorn thicket and we'll do. Quiet, Sam.
He spoke, Loki.
Tighten the rope, Jeff. These things will weigh it down. It needs to be taught.
Hey, you're getting a bit of a tune out of it now, Lukey.
I'll just be doing what the Squire showed us.
He showed us how, yeah, but he left us to do it.
He's the Squire. Besides, he's got a visitor.
So this meant to charm him or scare him then?
Who?
The spokes, Lukey. The Squire's spokes.
An eccentric name for a hostelry. The Three Companions. A donkey, a dragoon, and death, no less.
Presumably death is there to encourage more drinking.
I need no dire signage for that. Jethro.
Yes, master.
That landlord is taking an age with my brandy and the logs. Expedite one or other for me, will you?
Master.
Here you. Well, if not my brandy, then at least my quarry. You must be the squire.
Yes. Sir Timothy Hassel, at your service, sir.
Gideon Cobb. And likewise. And that makes three companions of us. Carry on, Jethro.
Master.
There were three of you already.
What do you mean, Jethro? I was told you were prone to strange ideas, sir.
He's caused quite a stir among the locals.
Indeed. I heard whisper that they think a black man must have come from the devil, not London.
They're one and the same to many round here.
And your wife has been most agreeable company whilst I awaited you, sir.
The pleasure was mine, Mr. Cobb.
Still no landlord, still no locks. London seems ever further away.
Your brandy, master?
Well, I prefer brandy to logs anyway. At least it washes away the coffee. That really was the work of the devil. Perhaps he's too busy spoiling your coffee to walk abroad tonight, eh, Squire?
My wife led me to believe you would be sympathetic to my experiments. That you were a man who understood the imponderable.
I understand much, and what I don't understand, I rationalise, sir.
And I too, sir. Through experimentation, through science.
Oh, I use the finest scientific equipment of all, sir. The human mind.
I felt from our meeting in London, Mr. Cobb, that you might be able to help.
Yeah, perhaps. But perhaps not in the way Sir Timothy expected. Your wife intrigued me, sir, but in your own words...
Well... Tonight, I fear, we may be hunting a manifestation of something.
Something is only manifest if it is witnessed. You say you have testimony?
Yes, from Tetsy.
The landlord's daughter?
Yes, she had instructions to be here. When my men get back, I'll send them looking. They've been roping off the area. It's a clearing in the woods with alarm bells. They shouldn't be long.
Your men are out laying traps for hoaxers?
Yes.
You admit it could all be an imposture, then?
To keep an open mind, I must. But I think not. I think there is something here worth probing with all the means we have.
All right. That's tight enough, Jeff.
Maybe the spokes will like your jingles.
You heard what he said?
Yeah, I only heard him say we're after spokes. Not surprised. Everyone knows these woods are cursed. But spokes will just pass clean through a rope. Don't I know that? Pass through anything a spoke can.
Ten spooks he's setting this up for. It's jokers. We got plenty of them hereabouts.
Loki?
Killing early tonight, that owl.
I've been walking these woods all my life, Loki. That weren't no owl. Sounded like a child crying out. It's got me thinking about what happened to old Job Mousley.
Oh, you've been talking about spooks so much it's getting to you, Jeff. See? Oh, rat squealing there. Make some folk frightened, they don't know what it were.
Ah, that weren't what I heard just now. Old Sam's got a sense of something.
Sam?
Has he found something?
Digging round one of the holes we made for the poles.
Found himself a mouse, most like.
Sam, what you got there, lad? Oh, he's got himself a bone, tis all. Jeff, shine your light here, man.
Not just one bone.
Just an animal carcass, now to be wary of.
Oh, it's too big for that. Look! More. Part of a skeleton.
Well, it's not a man. Too small.
Oh, Oh, it's a child. That's all in this place were cursed. It's the dead crying out that I heard. I said I heard a child's voice. I don't like this.
Let's get back to the inn. Squire's promised some ale, remember? I reckon you've earned it. I know you ain't doing this for the company.
Aye, aye. Squire may be soft in the head, but he's generous of that. Isn't that what it is? Lukey.
Order, Jeff!
Let go!
Tetsy! What are you doing out here in the dark?
I came to hear the voices.
Oh, not you too. You and Jeff make a right pair. Come on, girl, let's get you back this way.
Lukey, I don't want to come back here tonight.
You must think us very backward, Mr. Cobb.
Only your coffee. But coffee is the element I float in, madam, be it exquisite or vile. I never forget a bean. Each one's particular aroma conjures a time and place, such as Mrs. Brooks, where first we met. However bad the coffee is here, at least it's not one of these. What did you call them, Squire? Imponderable fluids. Sir, do you keep a chemical chamber at the hall and laboratory?
Yes.
You studied long?
A number of years. Mostly on my own.
Rewarding, eh?
Yes, indeed.
Often I scarce see him for a week. He's shut away there with his retort, and the whole parish may go rot.
Oh, singular. A squire that would sooner hunt a chemical element than a fox. But hunting with what? What is this, for example, this abomination?
Poor pussycat.
Ah, I think I can see the science behind those jars and fluids, sir. But the decapitated head of a cat atop this contraption. I'm sure this is science and not witchcraft.
All science seems like witchcraft until it is understood.
Yeah, well, what does it do?
It may provide additional attraction for electrical fluid.
How?
The whiskers.
I see. And she's ornamental too, in a way. Now, sir, you formed your theory already.
No,
don't protest. I can see you're positively agog with it.
In some sense...
A new proof of the existence of hobgoblins.
No, sir.
Then confound me, sir.
Imagine. Imagine that hereabouts, in the far past, there was some great catastrophic event.
Was there one?
So they say.
What?
That Queen Boadicea fled through the woods with her army.
I didn't know she came this far north.
She did. And there was a massacre. Now, is it not possible that an event of such spiritual force somehow imprinted itself on the very landscape?
The spiritual force you expect to detect with a poor, beheaded moggy. You do have an open mind.
I have to try everything. Even if only one contraption works, I'm prepared to risk your mockery and more for it, sir.
Your men are back in the woods.
Excellent.
Oh, we're finished, Squire.
You'd metal enough, Lukey?
Aye.
Tell me, was anything heard or seen?
Well, I ain't sure, Squire, but we found these.
Bones?
That's just the start of them, Squire. There's enough for a small skeleton, Squire, and Sam was sensing something, sir.
Sam's another witness?
My dog, sir.
A dog that gets agitated by a bone. What brave new world is this?
Well, not just the dog, sir. Big Jeff Beale, too, a bit. And we found Tetsy.
I wondered where she'd got to. Bring her in.
I'm here, sir. You don't have to fetch me.
Good girl.
I ain't coming in while he's here.
You have nothing to fear from Jethro. You have my promise.
Have your ale now, Lukey, but make sure Jeff keeps his head. I'm relying on you to maintain good order.
You can count on me, Squire.
Well, come along then, Tetsy. No need to be scared.
Are you honest, Tetsy?
I can answer for her. She's a hard worker.
Oh, no, I'm sure she can scrub these floors till they're spotless. Honest toil, yes, but are you honest in the mind?
What's he mean, sir?
Indeed, Mr. Cobb.
Honest with yourself. Not many achieve it.
Tetsy, Mr. Cobb has come from London to help us tonight. I think you should tell him your story.
Don't fear me, lass.
I am neither a judge nor a high constable. I am a philosopher. Do you know what that is?
Aye, sir, like the squire.
Not exactly like. As, alas, I have no access to those remarkable chemical jars, I am obliged merely to think about the truth. Come now.
Squire, I think he means to mock me.
I mock nothing but folly and knavery. Let us be two good people, you and I, eh? Helping each other to illumination. Jethro.
Master.
Take notes. Now we go. Tell me about the visitations.
'Twas last year.
Exactly a year ago tonight. The 27th day of October, 1768. And that night, you were out in the woods?
Yes, sir.
Alone?
Yes.
How long?
Hours. It was full dark when I heard the noises.
The noises?
Weren't much at first, like some sort of whistles or squeaks. And I thought birds, but 'twern't birds.
What were they then?
I don't know. Then they started to burst out more, very loud. And between whiles, there was quiet. And then I was laid on the ground and I could feel it starting to shake. And the noises came nearer, a roaring and a rattling like nor I ever did hear. I was frightened, sir.
Rattling of what? Wheels? Chains?
Neither one, I don't think.
Can you imitate any of these sounds for us with your mouth? Thank you. How did you set that down, Jethro?
A kind of buzz or hum.
Good.
There seemed to be voices, too.
Human voices?
Aye, sir. Yelling and screeching. Yelling for their lives by the sound of them. And footsteps running under the ground I was lying on.
You mean they ran in the earth?
Right under me where I lay. But the queer thing was, they sounded like feet on cobbles.
Footsteps on cobbles?
There's nothing but turf and leaf mould throughout the woods.
And the voices?
They were all round me. I stopped up my ears, but it made no matter. But I heard a little girl. I couldn't make out the words, but she sounded scared.
Did she speak in our tongue?
Some words might have been, I can't tell now. But mainly it was all screams and screeching. Near and far away too, like as if all the dead people was rising out of hell and covering up the land. And then it must have stopped, I don't recall. I run home, and when I seen the houses, I cried. The queerest of all, nobody else heard it.
No one?
I couldn't believe that, I couldn't.
Curse of being a woman. No one believes that what you say is important.
I'll tell you what you heard. An overwrought young woman in a lonely place. You heard your own heartbeats throbbing against the ground. You heard the small creatures of the undergrowth.
No, sir, no.
But chief of all, you heard your own memory. I'm told there's a local tale about that queen of ancient times.
They say she come through the woods with her whole army.
Ha! There, she knows it.
They say she killed plenty, and plenty were killed back, women and children too.
All those sad barbarians, sweating the blue woad off their bodies as they fled, tossing their spears away, yelling and screaming in their terror. And behind them, the trumpets and the drums, the rolling drums of the Roman army.
It may well have happened.
Happened or not is what she learned at her mother's knee. It's been in her mind since childhood, this fustian tale. When she's in an emotional state in the dark woods, it comes back to her, and there's your phantom army.
That wasn't what I heard. You tried to show me as a fool, sir. But I've thought about this many a day, as honestly as you'd wish. And I know, 'twere that old queen and her people that I heard. If they had come by here, they'd have had chariots. That's like carts, ain't it, sir? And horses. I'd have heard drums too, Mr. Cobb, and trumpets from when the soldiers came. 'Twas none of those. None of them.
Tetsy!
Come, sir, come. Oh. You realise what you're doing?
Tetsy!
You're reducing this very lack, this nothing, as if it supported her tail.
Tetsy.
I heard men running on a great cobbled road, sir, through them woods. But there's no road, nor ever has been.
That's true. It's always been forest land.
The noises, sir. When he hears the noises, he'll believe me.
Will you return to the woods, then? With us? Help us to understand.
I have to, sir. For my own peace of mind, if nothing else. I need to be rid of these noises, sir. I need to...
So, Mr. Cobb, what did you think to Tetsy?
Your frightened girl, a head full of old wives' tales.
She seemed honest in the mind.
Did she, sir?
Mm-hmm. When I was a child in Jamaica, ma'am, the generality of people believed in such things.
Ah, his people were savages, slaves.
That was no fault of theirs.
Who said it was?
Without benefit of religion, what else could...
Oh, they had religion enough. Demons, idols, voodoo.
Obeah, we called it, sir.
Obeah, then. Every possible consolation. What they lacked was the benefit of real human thought, of philosophy, which he lacks not.
Nonetheless, there may be forces whose nature is inaccessible to our finest philosophy.
As you see, he's had more than a flunky's training. He has a brain. I've made him use it.
We must hurry.
Not much of a moon tonight, Lukey.
No. So careful with your loading. This toppling over.
You want that on the card, sir? The electroscope.
So, you know what it is?
Yes. In spite of the cat.
Yes. Mm. Please load it off.
How much are you giving for them, Squire? If I bank this move?
A shilling a head.
And what about them that has no head?
Shilling a body.
Ah. Sorry's done its work on you, Jeff.
It's frightful cold, sir.
Ah. Tetsy, well, there are blankets on the cart if you want comfort.
I'm fine walking, sir.
Are you sure you want to come, Tetsy?
Yes.
We need her, Lukey. We can't guarantee the rest of us will hear with the same acuteness. Now, if Mr. Cobb would care to...
Go! Good Lord, I can't see the hand in front of my face.
Our country nights can be the blackest. Not nearly so many buildings throwing out light.
Perfect for a fantastical outbreak in the woods, I'd say. I'll be escorting your wife, Sir Timothy. You have other precious equipment to oversee.
I'm not sure he considers me to be quite so precious.
Very well.
I've wedged it into the cart, Sir Timothy. It's secure and covered.
Thank you, Jethro. If you wouldn't mind fetching my other instruments.
Of course.
Jethro is an experiment. You see, I make them too. On the whole, he works.
He's a man.
He is now. Almost. He was bought in slavery by an old friend of mine. I emptied his mind clean and poured in new impressions. I set him at all matters to seek truth, tested his brain against others in argument, and at last, that savage is the equal of any man in the kingdom.
Then why do you not respect him?
Respect? Respect, sir, is no part or parcel of the matter. You might as sensibly ask me to respect him for the silver buckles I put upon him.
I can respect him.
Sir, you have a vice of politeness in you.
Politeness a vice?
Many it is. Should your husband succeed this night, he'll beg pardon of the ghosts for raising him. And I notice you are happy to have my slave fetch and carry for you whilst respecting him as a man.
You speak so, Mr. Cobb.
And mean it too.
Yet you fight against slavery.
Slavery has always existed, madam.
You have written against it.
But not to signal my virtuousness. I have said it will come to an end. Not quite the same thing. Good or bad, it must end by being ridiculous. Machines will supplant it.
Machines?
Without a doubt. The great steam pumps we see now are going to have 1 million descendants. In 100 years, in 250 certainly, machines will do all the world's fetching and carrying. They'll carry men through the air and over the seas. They can free man from his folly, his savagery.
How can they? Man will have made them.
Yes. And they will sow and reap for us, water the deserts, melt
the polar snows.
All this with steam?
There'll be far greater forces.
The imponderables?
No, sir. Powerful, real forces that actually exist, that must exist to bind this universe and to quicken it. The very sources of life. Man will find them in the end, just as we created fire and found and forged metal.
Yes, I suppose so. As each of us contributes his...
Oh, my poor squire. Man will do it by using his mind utterly anew, plumbing the deepest levels of insight and reason, not by sniffing at those sorcerer's jars. The nose will not serve, sir, but to find a bad smell.
Well, we shall see.
'Tis the brain must do it, not the cat's whiskers.
That's everything, sir.
Thanks. Just stow it on top. Right, Jeff? Move it out.
Take my arm, madam. We should bring up the rear. That way the devil will have satisfied his appetite by the time he reaches us.
I like the way, Lukey.
Squire, come on, Sam.
Look against this root.
Right. Brace yourselves and heave.
This is the place, Squire. Through here.
Oh, it's so muddy.
Jethro, help the lady. I'll take the lantern.
Yes, Master.
I don't like it.
Cursed spot.
I didn't see the rope.
Timothy, you're not hurt.
No, the bones seem sound. Hey, Lukey.
Sound enough, sir. Well, sir, you sprung your own trap.
Yes, I... Well, you see how it works. It sets off the alarm if anyone... you saw.
Squire, we're just putting it to test, like.
Help me bring the cart further in and stop your chat, Jeff Beale.
Where's Tetsy?
Here, sir.
Now, show us the exact spot that you heard the noises.
Yonder, by the fallen tree.
Now, that'll serve, lads. Unload it, if you would.
How can I help, sir?
If you could place these thermometers evenly around this perimeter.
Of course.
Thermometers?
Well, it's said that supernatural events are marked by a great chilling of the air. I'm ready to test that.
Good. Perhaps the moggy will turn blue and all.
Now, my tripods. Bear them over here, Beale. To the planks. This way. This way. Luffy. Perhaps you could take me to where you found the bones.
Are you not to help him?
He has not taught me in these matters.
You don't surprise me. I've met a score of him. Gentlemen amateurs with a nose for idle novelty. But I've never encountered one who has co-opted the nostrils of a cat.
Nor these pots. These pans. These theatrical costumes. They, I think, are from Julius Caesar. They're to adorn the scene and... Heavens, they must be, to make the Roman ghosts feel at home.
I had a cat once, my lady. Her name was Tib, and she was a great killer. Oh, yes. There was something about her. She'd bring me the mouse and expect me to kill it. Finish it off for her. Stay here.
Sam, come here, leave him be. I reckon the dead is entitled to rest, but...
They're a child's bones, aren't they?
Not enough to tell. If there was time, I'd excavate further, but... It could be more evidence of some terrible cataclysm echoing to us from the past. Here, now, set these up on the tripod.
Surely you cannot catch imponderables in a jar by their very nature. They will escape through the glass. That is, if they exist at all.
Well, there may be something else.
Oh?
Something heavier. An animal magnetic fluid. I should call it that. Something like the magnetic fluid of iron, but exuded instead by living creatures.
Is this your own idea?
Suppose it had the quality of lingering, say, where some violent action of the past had riven it into the earth to issue forth again at certain times and under certain conditions. Times like the yearly cycle. At each anniversary of some great disaster. Lantern, Lukey. Here. as if part of the vital spirits of the people there had been torn away under the dreadful pressure of fear and death.
Part of their souls?
My dear, I think the squire means something more chemical than souls. Besides, Queen Boadicea may be officially doubted to have had one. She was a pagan, but the squire will insist on the old queen. She fits his theory. So if she shows herself tonight, he'll bottle her up.
You've made quick progress tonight, Lukey. Well done. Here.
Toasting forks?
Yes. Another of my own ideas. Wedge them there in the thorn bush.
Right.
Okay. Are you ready up there, Lukey? We'll have the wire coils and then come down yourself.
Right, old squire. Throwing them down now.
Right. And join them to the electroscope?
No. Those to a Leyden jar. Can you do that?
Yes, sir.
I've made trial before with electrical discharges. During thunderstorms.
With kites like Benjamin Franklin.
That's right. Flying forks up into the storm. The fluid comes down the wet line. I got a bad burn once.
Well, shall we get burns tonight?
I'd be glad to. With so many people here, it may excite the forces.
I'll secure them as best I can.
Thank you. Now, secure a lantern here, Lukey.
I know, sir. Sir, word. Before this addled attempt goes too far, and you're the laughingstock of the entire county. Think of your lady there. We're all out here on the word of this one emotional girl. Not one other person has witnessed anything.
Not true, sir. Job Mousley did.
Who? An old poacher. 3 years ago, he was in the woods on what must have been the same night of the year. But that signified naught until Tetsu...
Where is this old man?
He died. Very next day.
Oh, of shock, no doubt.
He was took mortal strange.
Oh, how disobliging of him. Oh, you're a singular fellow, sir, but do not set up to be an eccentric.
Sir, what about the bones found by the men?
They weren't deep enough to have been from Boadicea's time. They could be from any number of unfortunate waifs to have perished here over the years of cold, of malnutrition. I've heard it's possible to die of embarrassment, which you, sir, are in grave danger of doing. Where did you get all of this rubbish? From a bankrupt sorcerer? You don't know what half of it is, the half that isn't theatrical properties.
I make serious observations.
The best of them are so crude you can prove whatever you fancy. That mice are generated by sour cheese, that sneezing endangers the monarchy.
I am not a fool, sir.
Then throw away the toys.
I have an open mind.
Close it, sir. Close it to nonsense.
Keep your voice down.
In case your wife hears. She wants to. And if you want the truth, I can tell you how to find it.
Pray do.
You need not seek it with quaint instruments. You have only to open your eyes, if you can, and see what is before you.
That is too easy.
It is not easy. It is so hard that only a handful have yet achieved it. Men must scour their minds clean, ready for a new usage. Turn their whole imagination right round, away from all the romantic fancies that first delight it, and then blur, and finally deaden it. And bring that imagination to bear instead on the real world, the world hitherto taken for granted. See into it. Seek its deepest sense. The truth is all around us, but it is hard and ordinary and supreme.
Have you achieved this cleansing of the brain?
Not wholly, but I shall.
And how many others?
In time, a worldful. Man will change himself.
I could not.
No.
I didn't see you there, madam.
Please, continue.
I was just going to say that your husband, yes, you, sir, and all men like you will be left behind. A mere bone in the rocks, like a creature of the great flood, or whatever it was that dog dug up here. The men of the future will be those who see things as they are.
Go on, Timothy. Argue, refute him.
How can I? He denounces fantasy only to set up another one.
I give good sense for nonsense. New lamps for old.
Bravo!
Come, sir, try the exchange. He will not.
I stand for knowledge, sir. to broaden man's horizons. You seem to see progress at the bottom of a brandy barrel.
There we have it. The crutches of petty, trammeling morality. We'll have no need of them.
Faith, is there morality now?
No, but they'll be spared the pretense. They may count our virtues vice and our vices natural wisdom. Judgment will be fresh, earned by enlightenment.
God will judge.
They will judge. They won't go in dread seeking heavenly marks for good behavior. They'll have no filth and cholera and killing for theft. Who will steal in a world where every man's a prince? There'll be neither God nor law. We'll have outgrown them. No squire nor servant.
Nor slave.
Nor slave. They'll have such riches, there'll be no need. They'll build a world that's clean and ordered and swift. It'll come. It must.
The world of machines?
Aye, great engines. Man will have no need of gods then, nor of spectral monsters. No disease, no cruelty, no want.
You blind us with your golden age, Mr. Cobb.
Shh. Birds, man, surely.
I think not. Lavinia, stay with Mr. Cobb.
You were saying just now that immorality is what gives us pain. Then the London wives and their lovers must suffer a great deal?
Not a bit.
But surely...
They're not immoral. They're enjoying a natural virtue. What morality is there in being tied to a dotard, for instance?
Or a dullard. I begin to understand.
And I begin to understand you. Vicar's daughter, yes? Oh. Saw the squire as a way up, but found he didn't make the ascent exciting. No, I've much to learn.
Then learn it, I must.
You'll find me an excellent teacher. In fact, I...
Mr. Cobb, are you all right?
Tetsy!
It's like she's possessed.
Convulsing. I've seen it before. It's a medical phenomenon, not supernatural.
The noise.
Sounded like a shot somewhere across the valley.
No. It was here. All right. Shh. Easy, girl. It's gone now.
I've seen the road.
What does she say?
Like a lightning flash, I've seen it. There wasn't no trees, but a huge, wide road and things moving. Didn't you see it?
I felt something. I sensed it.
I saw nothing.
Jethro, help him.
Oh, let me. Cobb, are you all right, man?
A touch of dyspepsia. I must have eaten too quickly. Rather distressful.
You saw it, sir. You saw it?
I heard a curious sound.
Nothing else, Cobb?
Just my stomach. Greed, you see, as I said earlier, a clear example of vice. It has its rewards, but it's so painful.
That's from the perimeter. My blunderbuss! Quickly!
He was lying.
Were you?
Jethro.
Were you? Be honest. Be honest.
I will not have you speak, sir.
Here in this place, I can. I'm not real to you, am I? I'm something you made. Not a man. But the man is speaking to you now. Mr. Cobb, you have a great mind, but there are too many things it won't admit. Mean, troubling things. Things that'll spoil your grand design. You can't make a new world just with words. Not even all your words, Mr. Cobb. It'll be no good if man's mind has not developed enough to use this new world responsibly.
The perimeter!
Don't shoot. I was only messing. I wanted to spook you.
Jeff!
Oh, you damn fool! Now get back to your position and thank God that you didn't get it through the middle.
What was it?
Big Jeff Beale. I frightened him. That'll curb his messing.
Oh, I missed, ma'am. No harm done.
He doesn't normally miss.
I didn't.
Sorry, Squire. I did warn him.
He's a simpleton. Now back to your post, Lukey.
Righto, sir.
Did he cause... the other...
No. No, that was something else.
What happened?
My husband just shot at one of his own men.
Good God. How much longer are we to share this midnight party for the yokels?
You're shaking.
Is this infernal cold?
Thermometers. They've gone down by 7 Fahrenheit degrees in these last few minutes. Have you noticed the air temperature? It's dropped.
Yes, I've noticed. And so has Mr. Cobb.
Normal at this time of night, surely, out here in the open.
It's not normal,
sir. Are you bent on spreading alarm? Not only to the women.
The barometer's down, too. All in the past 5 minutes.
You have these simple men in terror. I appeal to you, Squire, not to submit to superstition.
Oh, quiet.
I don't think you have the smallest idea what you're doing.
I'm setting down facts. Even if I don't know what I'm doing, if I make these readings for all the wrong reasons, there's no doubt about them. If I don't find out their meaning, someone else will. They'll take this notebook, as I've taken other men's, and they'll read it and use it. It will be there to use.
Why do I suddenly find danger in you? Yes, danger. Madam, make sure you despise your husband for the right reasons.
I don't understand.
He is ruthless in his way. One of a blind, mad pack. They will do things. Blindly playing with forces they don't understand. I had not considered this. My golden age endangered by the folly of man.
What do you mean?
Let us leave this place.
No.
I'm afraid now. You know that.
Yes.
And you want to watch it? Of course you do. Cat and mouse.
Squire!
Your instruments in the clearing, come quickly!
Is that you, Squire?
Hi, Lukey! Stay there, we need you as high in the tree as possible.
These instruments, they're reacting. Atmospheric disturbance must be vibrating the tuning forks.
What is it?
It's how it began before.
Help me with some of these readings. That box, quick! It's definitely registering an electrical charge.
Squire! Squire! Stay where you are, Lukey, but don't touch the metal!
Sam, come back. Boy, smoke, sir.
Back to your post, man. Jethro!
It's real. It's real.
Stand your ground, man.
Not me, Squire. I ain't staying here to die.
Come back.
Mr. Cobb, say what this is. I know you can. You must.
Go. Do you see anything?
No, not now.
Nor I. I don't understand.
Quickly! Sir! Get out of here!
I mustn't!
Oh, dear Lord! God save you, Squire!
Lukey!
Hear the road now. Hear them running there. Help me! Oh, help me! Something has got hold of my leg!
You've caught your foot in the roots, that's all. Here. Take my tunic. Master, you must come.
Listen. It's machines. Please. Machines, Jethro. Great machines. This can be nothing of the past.
Master!
I must hear. Leave me.
What's happening?
We just need to leave the car for a little bit.
Don't worry. Just do
your
time.
God Almighty. I can see them.
Head for the bridge.
Who, Master?
People. Fleeing. Fighting for their lives. Trampling each other underfoot. Imprinting their terror in the earth beneath us. Machines, we can't conceive. Machines to carry man. Shining metal.
Please, stay safe and try not to panic.
You can see them, Master.
I can smell their fumes.
Oh, my God.
blood. We will be dead before she's born. Oh, I can see them. I can see the road.
Where is it?
Beneath our feet. People, carriages, not like Boadiceus forged by iron. Obedient machines. Obedient.
Sophie, oh, Sophie.
I got knocked over.
Oh, my baby.
I'm scared.
Don't be scared. It's just
a flash. Was that the missiles?
I heard fragments of that. They said, what was it? Missiles.
Oh, merciful God.
I missed it. That's going to be too far away. Radio's dead.
I see them all. All.
I do too. The girl, the little girl.
Peace,
peace. What's that?
It's a special cloud, Sophie. Hold on tight. That's it. Now, close your eyes and make a wish. Wish for anything you like and it'll happen.
Cobb, what did you see? Who were they? You did see? Tell me. Tell me.
I saw.
I must know.
She saw too.
Titty, I...
Leave her be. She's dead. I felt her heart burst.
Dead?
The machines. The wonderful machines that will free us all.
I must know. I need the knowledge.
And what would you do with it? What world would you make with your knowledge?
Timothy, get me out of here.
No, but...
Take me home. Now.
Peace, girl. Peace. Master, you're safe now. It's gone.
Safe? We are, yes. Yet someday men will come here. Machines will come. Impossible machines. And they will make a great road through these very woods. A road. A road.
Gideon Cobb was played by Mark Gatiss and Sir Timothy Hassel by Adrian Scarborough. Lady Lavinia Hassel was Hattie Morahan, Jethro Colin McFarlane, Tetsy Susan Wacoma, Lukey Platt Francis McGee, and Big Jeff Beale Ralph Ineson. The Road was written by Nigel Neal and adapted for radio by Toby Haydock. It was directed by Charlotte Riches. Thank you.